Hello, this is Dr. Keith Miller again, and today we'll be looking at the methods by which we record relative geologic time. Relative geologic time is simply the ordering of events in geologic history. In other words, just determining the sequential order in which a series of geologic events occurs. It does not involve assigning dates, but simply placing things in their proper chronological order. And there are a number of very simple, straightforward principles that are very powerful in doing this. So these are often called Steno's principles, in addition to a few other principles. So this includes things like original horizontality, which says that the vast majority of sedimentary layers are originally deposited horizontally because of the effects of gravity. So if they're not horizontal anymore, that means that something has had to tilt or deform them in some way. Another is superposition. That says if you have a stack of layers, the layer at the bottom is older than the layer at the top. So we get a timeline going from the bottom to the top. Another is the cross-cutting relationships. Cross-cutting relationships state that if you have a series of layers and you have another structure that cross-cuts that, could be an igneous intrusion, it could be a fault, could be anything that cuts across the pre-existing set of rock layers, that cross-cutting structure has to be younger than the rest of the stack that it cross cuts. There's also the importance of unconformities. And these are erosion surfaces that can represent vast amounts of time. And quite a number of different events are all confined to that particular erosion surface. So there's a number of other tools that are used, but those are the main ones that I'll be focusing on in this video. And what I'll be doing is looking at some block diagrams, which is what we'll be doing in lab, particularly cross sections, I should say. And we'll be using those geologic cross sections to understand how we can take those cross sections and interpret the sequence of events represented in that cross section. So let's go ahead and get started. So here we have a very simple geologic cross section. So we have a series of beds. We have an intrusion, an igneous intrusion. We have a fault. So in approaching any geologic cross section, again, because of the law of superposition, the principle of superposition, you always start at the bottom. So you always start at the bottom of the cross section and work your way up, and then take into consideration cross-cutting relationships and the other principles we talked about. So we'll start here and I'll list them from bottom to top. So the very first thing that's going to happen here is the deposition of this lowermost bed. Based on superposition, this has to be the oldest. So we'd start out here with deposition of C. Then, following that, we have deposition of B. Then, deposition of A. Now we notice here that we have a cross-cutting relationship. So remember, the cross, whatever structure cross-cuts pre- other structures has to be younger. So D has to be younger than A, B, and C, because here we can see that the intrusion also cuts through A. So it cuts through all three of those units, so it has to come later. But we notice another cross-cutting relationship, which is this fault. This fault has cross-cut and displaced this igneous intrusion. So that fault had to occur after this intrusion. So our next order is that we have intrusion D. Following that, we have the fault E. But there's actually one last event, because we've had this fault. This is a normal fault, so I can make that more specific. So this is a normal fault. The headwall block has gone down relative to the footwall block. But the landscape here has been eroded off. So the last event here is erosion. Okay, so that's a fairly simple sequence of events. So let's move to a little more complicated one. And this is actually a real situation. This is a cross-section across the Grand Canyon. So we can now look at what recorded events, in what order they occur in the Grand Canyon. So again, we start at the bottom of the sequence. So we start at the very bottom of the cross-section. And what we see down here, this is, it's called the Vishnu Schist. That's a metamorphic rock. Well, that isn't the first event, because there were pre-existing rocks that had to be metamorphosed and deformed. So it's actually the deposition of those initial rocks that is the first event that's recorded. So we have deposition of these sedimentary rocks. And without further information, we don't know what the nature of those sedimentary rocks are. But then, so then there's metamorphism, but notice here there's the Zoroaster granite, which is an intrusion that has cross-cut the structures in the schist, so we know that this had to happen later. So now we have another event. So the next thing here is the deformation and metamorphism of those rocks to form the Vishnu Schist. Then we have the intrusion of the granite. So that's where we are so far. Now, notice that there's a surface here that has truncated, cut off these units. That's an erosion surface, okay? That is an unconformity, a particular type of unconformity called a nonconformity. So resting on top of this metamorphosed and intruded rock is an erosion surface. So this represents a lot of time, because whatever the previous landscape was has been eroded down to a fairly flat surface. That surface then had to be subsided below sea level to allow the deposition of these rocks, many of which are marine in origin. So the next step here is I'll just say formation of non-conformity. Remembering that that unconformity itself represents a number of events. Represents uplift, erosion, and subsidence. All had to occur to allow the deposition of the next series of units right here. Okay, so that's the next series. And again, this would be a whole series of events in and of itself. Excuse me here while I fix this. So we now have the deposition of the uncar group, which is this series of layers here. And again, that took a lot of time. There's a lot of it that's actually thousands of feet thick. So there's thousands of feet of different sedimentary rocks representing different sedimentary environments involved in just that stack of sediments. Now, notice that we have another irregular surface. These beds are all tilted. So before they were eroded off here, all these units had to be tilted. So we have a tilting event. So we have tilting of the beds. Now we have another, this is called an angular unconformity because the beds underneath this erosion surface are at an angle relative to those on top. So now we have the formation of an angular unconformity. And again, that represents a lot of time. In this case, it represents a time of uplift, an erosion of that uplifted and deformed surface. Again, subsidence below sea level, because the next unit on top of it is actually a beach sandstone. So these series of rocks here represent shallow sea environment. So we now have that position of these sedimentary rocks. Again, representing a variety of environments, in this case, shallow marine rocks, again, over a considerable period of time, different types of environments. There's beach sands, there's shales, there's limestones. And then we have another erosion surface. And in fact, this has a lot of topography on it. There's actually channels eroded into the bottom of this thing that were done in a terrestrial environment by rivers, channels cutting through the underlying topography or cutting through the surface exposure of that time. So we have another unconformity. In this case, it's called a disconformity, because the beds above and below are largely parallel to each other. And now we have another stack of rocks. And this is the deposition of the red wall, what's called the red wall limestone, which is a really prominent unit in the Grand Canyon. And again, that means that during this time of erosion, there was uplift, that those limestones were raised, were deposited underwater, were raised up. They were then eroded down to a relatively horizontal surface. Then that whole thing was subsided again to allow the deposition of the next units, which is the Supai group. So we have, again, formation of another disconformity, and then the deposition of the Supai group and rocks above. And then finally, on this top layer would be the erosion of the Grand Canyon itself. Yeah, well, let me do that. Okay. So again, your last event here would be the erosion of the Grand Canyon itself, which itself took a period of time, a significant period of time. So what I would encourage you to do, this cross-section is in your textbook, which actually shows a series of diagrams, block diagrams progressively through time, showing how this particular hypothetical geologic section would have been formed. And I would really encourage you, as another kind of practice before lab, to look at this section in your textbook. This is not in your lab book, in your textbook, and be sure that you understand how that sequence of events was reconstructed using the tools that I've talked about, as well as some of the additional tools that are mentioned in your textbook. So this would be another good practice before lab, to be sure that you understand how you go about recording a sequence of events from the geologic record. So I wish you success in your time in the lab, and we'll also be looking at incorporating that recognition of a sequence of events with, later in the lab, with identifying actually numerically dated horizons that then you can use to place actual dates on that timeline that is created by the relative dating.